and the society we live in, there are so many things that could cause us to worry first at the start of 2019. Economically, socially, ranging from Brexit to all the challenges that we face here in Britain and around the world. We turn on the news and we can see so many challenges, and worry fills our mind. And I've learned that seeking God first is the antidote to worry. The more we're full of prayer, the more we trust God for our future, the less room we give to worry. And the sooner we start praying, the less stress we're going to carry forward in our life. The sooner we start to seek God, the less anxiety and fear that we're going to have. That's why Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, and you're going to hear me say this a lot over these next 21 days. The Bible promises this, that God is able to do even more than we could ask or imagine. Is there anybody here who believes that promise over their lives at the outset of 2019? It seems to me that if God would do even more than we can ask, that we should get busy asking God for more. Why not ask God for more at the outset on our first Sunday? If God's ready to do more, let's lift the level of our ask. And there is nothing wrong with asking God for more. It is not selfish to ask God for more. I know people might think that, but I think honestly that's a lie from an enemy to try to separate you from the goodness of God. There is nothing wrong with asking God for more. What about a family member or a friend who needs to find Jesus in 2019? That's the more we should all ask for. What about a goal or a dream that you've had in your heart for a long time? Maybe it's a goal to start a new life group or a goal to start a new business idea. There is nothing wrong with asking God for more. In fact, we see throughout the Bible that Jesus said, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things are going to be given to you as well." And so by seeking God first on the first Sunday, by seeking God in prayer at the beginning of your day or at the end of your day, God is going to help you move from where you are to where you want to be. Cast your mind forward. Where would you like to be at the first Sunday of 2020, a year from now? Who would you like to be with you in this service a year from now? Where would you like to be economically, financially? Where do you want to be? Well, it's that mindset that'll help you pray and focus your prayer forward. If you can break down your life like that and think, where do I want to be in the next year? Then we're going to help pray in our life. Now think about this. Jesus, he asked us to pray and he taught us to pray, but he also demonstrated it. He took a ragtag group of disciples that make me laugh and they make me feel better about the weaknesses in our own lives. And when you think about the one who doubted God, you think about Thomas, who always seems to just never have the faith to step up and believe. You see Peter, who was impetuous and always saying and blurting out the wrong thing at the wrong time. And then, of course, you had a betrayer in the midst of Jesus who actually didn't make it to the next level. Judas betrayed him. I mean, when I see the disciples that Jesus used, and then you follow their track and you see where they ended up in the book of Acts, Jesus transformed them, but he transformed them by teaching them how to pray about their own life. And this is the first thought I wanted to come agreement with as a church is this. Prayer is the fuel that will transform your fear into faith. If you have need of transforming your life in any area, prayer can be your fuel. Prayer can be your energy. Prayer can be your source. Why? Because Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31 says this, "Those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength." Who needs their strength renewed in 2019? I mean, you might be here and you might be realizing that your body is getting older, but I want to let you know, your energy level don't even depend on what your body tells you. Your productivity and your energy level can be determined by your Father God, because he is so good and he loves you so much. And so we're coming as a leadership team letting you know, church, we love you so much. We are so for you, and we're believing that God is going to do more for you than you could ever dare ask, hope, or imagine. And so I'm asking you to line up your life with this idea of fueling your life with prayer. And at the end of this service, we've written a prayer guide that we're gonna give every person here free, that's gonna be good, to help focus your thinking about how to pray. So together, as a church family, we can launch forward. And that's why Jesus said this. He said, when you pray, not if you pray, but when you pray. Yeah. You know, it's like we've got to decide, church, that prayer is not an option. Prayer is not something that we can leave it, we can kind of leave it on the table, we can pick and choose it. No, prayer is essential to your spiritual life. Just like food is essential to your body, prayer is the fuel for your spiritual inner being. And as I bring this to you, I want you to know that I'm not a travel agent here, I'm a tour guide. In other words, I'm not saying, hey, go there. No, I wanna go with you into discovering how great God is. And I've learned that the past few years, I've been practicing 21 days of prayer, and I've really been enjoying the depth of how God reveals himself over that period of time. And so I'm not just saying do it, and I'm gonna watch you and kind of sit on the sidelines. No, together we're in this. We're reaching our world together. We're reaching Yorkshire together. And prayer is so important. So I'm not saying go and do it. No, I'm saying let's do it together. Let's pray together. That's what we've written, that prayer journal. And that's what Jesus modeled. He prayed with people early in the morning, late at night. Sure, he had moments when he had solitary prayer. Sure, we all have those moments. But there's something about gathering together in the ones and twos and threes, gathering together as a church where you bear your soul to each other in prayer that is so powerful. And that's why I want to teach you these three simple things we're going to do today, as these three simple things to get us going that everybody can do, because I want to make this simple. Because I realized there was so much condemnation around when it comes to prayer. So many people feel so guilty for not having a stronger prayer life, me included. And you know, prayer is simply enjoying our relationship with God and talking to him. That's all it is. We can all do this. And so that's why I wanted to focus on Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. We're going to look at Matthew chapter 6 and dive into that whole chapter, because this is where Jesus started his ministry. And he started and he sat on a hillside, gathered his close followers together, and he said, hey, when you pray, find a quiet, secluded place so that you won't be tempted to role play before God. I love that. No posturing before God. No trying to have your own agenda, just simply be. And Jesus said, just be as simple and honestly as you can manage. And the focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense his grace. There is nothing more powerful than being in your own home in a quiet place or going for a walk and sensing the presence of God. Now, you might think, well, I've never sensed the presence of God. Well, let's break this down. First of all, choose a time to pray. Choose a time. It doesn't matter if it's the last thing at night or if it's early morning. It doesn't matter when it is. But choose a moment in your life and be consistent with that time. Set your alarm clock an extra 15 minutes earlier. Just take 15 minutes. And that 15 minutes, seek God. And then secondly, there's no special place or environment to pray in. Just get there. Just choose a time, choose a place, secondly, and finally, and this is where we're gonna focus our time together here, choose a way to pray. Right. Now, a lot of people don't understand this, but there are different ways the Bible teaches to pray. And if you've been around the things of God for a while, you know this, but approaching your Bible and just hoping that something pops out to bless you, just hoping something arrives will get you through a lot of tough times in life. But let's be intentional about seeking God in the good times. Let's seek God when we're strong. Let's approach the Bible and have a plan. Not just a smorgasbord or I hope something happens, but let's have a plan. There's all kinds of different ways we can read and pray the Bible. You can grab the Bible and you can read one chapter and you can pray that through over the course of a few days or a few weeks. You can fast. Fast means abstain from food. We don't talk about it much in our culture today, but it's a good way. Jesus taught about fasting, and fasting elevates your prayer life. You know, there's all kinds. You can worship. You can do all kinds of different things in your prayer life. I want to take you to probably one of the most simple, clear, the way Jesus taught it, Lord's Prayer in the Bible, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. And Jesus taught us that this is how we should pray. And he started with the first point by saying this: we should pray to our Father in heaven. I love that. Stop right there. God is your loving Father. How we approach God changes our entire approach to life. If we know that God loves us and he's for us and he's a great Father, ready to give us whatever we ask him for, it changes the way we ask God. On the other hand, if you think God is stern and cold and far from you and doesn't care about the details of your life, that will affect the way you pray. I want to let you know, God cares about every challenge you're facing right now. He cares about your most embarrassing moments. He cares about every aspect of your life because he's a loving Father. In fact, that word Father literally means Abba. And it's a little word that a child would speak about God, Abba Father, one of the shortest Hebrew words, so that anybody could approach God. And in that analogy right there, Abba Father, is what Jesus taught. He is our Abba Father. God is our loving Father. Why should we not approach God and let him know about the desires and the dreams and the challenges that we face? We should do that. And you know, a great way to do this is to journal and write down day one. Day one, these are the things I'm believing for in 2019. These are my dreams. These are my goals. And write them down and begin to pray over them. But let's have that starting place with God being our Father. You know, one of the things I love most in life is to be around when my children, I've got two kids, and they're teenagers now. When they come home from school, I love to just be in the house. I don't get to do it much because of work, but when they come home from school, I love them piling in, and I can look at their faces, and I just know by the look on their face what kind of day they had. Are you like that? I know when they're hungry. I know when they're stressed out. I know when they're frustrated. And God, our Heavenly Father, looks at our life, and he knows what you need before you even ask. God looks at your life. He knows. He's seen every behind-the-scenes moment of your life. He knows what you need. And so let's have this starting place, that God being our Father. And if we can have that starting place, then we can move to the next section of the Lord's Prayer, which is this: hallowed be your name. Now, that word hallowed, I mean, that's a weird word, okay? I had to look it up in the Bible dictionaries because I don't really understand what hallowed means. It's been a long time since anybody said, hallowed be to me. So I honestly didn't understand. And sometimes the Bible takes digging in. When you dig in, hallowed, this word literally means to be set apart or to be greatly honored. And it was talking about the name of God. And I did some research about this. And the name of God was so holy and so precious and so reverent that the Old Testament Jews were forbidden to actually say the name of God. So they had to have nicknames for God, and they had nicknames Jehovah, and they had nicknames that were about God's character. So they called him Jehovah Jireh, which means God is our provider. They said things like Jehovah Rapha, he's the God who heals us. And the point of this is that when we approach God, we have to realize how sovereign he is, how holy he is. And right now, I know that there's somebody here, you need to experience the healing power of God in 2019. And so let God be your healing Father. That's in the power of his name. Maybe you need to know God is salvation. Well, that's in the power of the name of God. Whatever you need from God, he is ready to give it to you in 2019. He is all-knowing and all-powerful. And so in our approach to God, we're saying, okay, God, I know you're my Father, you love me, but I also know You are powerful beyond all comprehension. God has the power to give you a new job. God has the power to help you with your ideas in 2019. God has the power to help you overcome some of the areas of self-discipline that you need in your life. All that is in your approach to who God is. Is this helping anybody? I've got a lot more to go, and I'm only on the second phase of this. Let's keep going. The next aspect of this whole Lord's Prayer is this. When Jesus taught us to pray like this, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, what does Jesus mean by the kingdom coming? This has confused so many people over the last 2,000 years. The kingdom coming literally means this, the reign and rule of God within the hearts of God's people. That's the kingdom coming. In other words, the kingdom of God does not start when we die, when we go to heaven. The kingdom of God starts when we accept Jesus. When we accept him as our Lord and Savior, the kingdom of God begins at that point. And his reign and rule begins to move forward. What that means is this, God's will is so important. In fact, I would even say this, God's will is to be more trusted and to be more relied on than our own will. Why do we say that? Because God loves us so much, he knows what we need. And you know, we say, well, we're praying our will. Often we pray, God, you know, please can you do this for us? Well, I've discovered that praying God's will takes us to another level. Why? Because God wants us to have the desires of our heart. Right? We've already talked about how God is our loving Father. So by praying God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that's a game changer for all of us. This is how we take the chains of addiction and see them broken in our generation. If God's kingdom comes to the earth, that means all corruption, all addiction, all the lies and the hypocrisies of our generation will be broken because of who God is. So we're praying, God, let your kingdom come to Yorkshire. Let your kingdom come in this region. Why? Because God's kingdom coming will change our society. And there's so much foolishness and there's so much silliness going on today. There's so many things that just, I look at them and they break my heart when I hear about them. When I hear about the abuse, when I hear about things today, that the suffering that's so unneeded in our generation. It causes me to pray for God's justice to be done. It causes me to pray for his righteousness to come. It causes me to pray, God, I pray for our government. I pray for our police. I pray for our political leaders because we want his kingdom to reign throughout Great Britain. And it's that sense of prayer that brings power to our church. People think the kingdom and the church are at opposites. No, the kingdom of God creates the church. The kingdom of God comes first, and then his local church is created. And I want to say this, that being planted in the house of God is doing the will of God. In the Bible, there was no difference between the kingdom of God out here and the local church over here. In fact, I would even go to say that if you say, well, I'm part of the kingdom of God, but you're not anchored in the local church, you're not doing the will of God. Because Jesus is the head of his church, and it's impossible. You know, people say, well, God can do the impossible. Of course he can. But there are also some things that God has committed not to do, like this. You cannot be connected to your heavenly Father without being connected to your brothers and sisters in Christ. It's an impossibility. You can't say, I'm serving God without being connected. How do I know that? Because the Bible teaches that again and again and again. Let's keep on going, because I've only got 9 minutes to finish this, and I've got so much to bring. And then Jesus went on to say this, give us this day our daily bread. I love that, because Jesus literally is our daily bread. Jesus is the living word of God. And if we're going to keep believing, we're going to have to keep receiving the daily word of God. And one of the things that I've committed to at the outset of this year, again, is to read my Bible. Get a Bible plan. I don't know what your Bible plan is, but I'll let you know what mine is. You can make up your own. I'm reading the chronological Bible through in 1 year. That's what I've decided to do in 2019. And what that means is this is a great way to do this is YouVersion have a free app. You can go sign up for a daily Bible reading plan, and it emails you through so that you're gonna read whatever it is. What I'm saying is, for you, you may not wanna do that. Read the Bible chronologically. Maybe you wanna read a different section of the Bible, a different way, but choose it. Make a plan. Don't just stumble through. Be intentional about it. And then if you miss a day or two, don't get condemned about it. Just catch it up. Skim read and get back on track again. I think that so many great things that we start, New Year's resolutions, now we are already almost at the back end of the first week of the new year. I don't know about you, but how many New Year's resolutions have already been broken? The gyms, you watch them, all the people say, how am I gonna get in shape this year? You know what? They're gonna run out of steam. I read a statistic that said 60% of people that are paying money that just joined a gym at the outset, 1st of January, will not be going to the gym by the 1st of February, but they're still gonna be paying their money. Right? It's like, not smart. So what I'm saying is, our daily bread moves us into a place of motivation and past disappointments and to live inspired when we start to feed our soul daily with the Word of God. Who is Jesus? And when I look around in this part of the world, there are so many people who do not understand that Jesus can be your strength. He can be your strength when you feel like you are weak. Don't let yourself be in a place where you're like, well, I'm not going to feel, I'm like this. I'm gonna read my Bible when I feel strong. When I feel strong, I'll get my Bible out and start reading it again. No, when you're depressed, when you're downcast, when you have no reason that you can think of to praise God, read your Bible and stick to the discipline of your life. And it won't be long before you start to sense the grace of God again. That's why I'm saying, make Jesus your daily bread and he will feed you. Your spirit needs feeding, not just this Sunday, but every day throughout the year. Feed your spirit. Make that a daily habit, a daily habit. Make that daily habit, feed my soul daily. Now let's keep going. And then Jesus said this, and this is all in the Lord's Prayer. He said this, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now this is getting hard. Jesus, have you ever prayed, Jesus, I wish you would just take this out of the Bible. Maybe it's just me being honest. But if you've lived a while and you've been disappointed or you've been let down by people, you have a reason to forgive somebody. You need to forgive somebody. Now, God gives us all a gift of eternal life when we accept Jesus, but forgiveness is the gift we give ourselves. Why do I say that? Because if you don't forgive other people, that area of unforgiveness will allow bitterness to creep into your soul, and it will damage your joy. It will damage your productivity. It will damage you believing God for the impossible in 2019. So forgiveness is key. And if there is anyone at all that you need to forgive, you need to forgive them. And I've done some self-examination before I came up here and started to talk about this. And as far as I'm aware, there is no one in my life that I need to forgive because I've already done it. Now, there's probably somebody in the back row thinking, Steve, you didn't forgive me. Well, you're forgiven in Jesus' name. Why? Because that's how we should live. We should be the first. And I know this is hard, and I've really had to work at this. I've been terrible at this in my life until recent years, and now I'm much better at it. Be the first to say I'm sorry. See, I used to be really defensive. I really had to work at this. But forgiveness means you need to forgive yourself, you need to forgive other people, and not hold back anyone else in your life. Forgiveness is so powerful. Why did Jesus talk about this in prayer? And when I asked that and I approached the word, I believe it's because unforgiveness is the number one greatest hindrance to your prayers being answered. It really is. Unforgiveness will hold back the goodness of God over your life. And so by forgiving and living in a place of forgiveness, you're gonna move forward. I just need to linger here a moment longer. I've seen the damage of unforgiveness personally in my own family. I watched my mother, particularly my mother, really struggle with forgiving because she went through a divorce And in the divorce, he'd been married 32 years. She really got hung up over unforgiveness towards her ex-husband. And, you know, we as kids were all involved in the blended family of all this. And it was really hard. But the joy is she finally came to a place of forgiveness. I get it. There might be real valid reasons when you struggle to forgive somebody. Maybe they treated you really badly. I just want to say what happens is the sweetest revenge that you will ever experience is total forgiveness. If you want sweet revenge, forgive them. Forgive the people who hurt you so you can get on living your life. Don't live in that prison of unforgiveness any longer. Exercise sweet revenge and say, no, I'm forgiving. I'm forgiving that person who hurt me, and now I'm getting on with my life. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you need to spend lots of time with somebody to prove it, right? Say, well, I forgave you. Now you need to be my best friend. No, you just need to forgive them and trust your life with trustworthy people. If you've hung out with people who are not trustworthy, don't trust them. Forgive them, but move on. See the difference? Jesus didn't say trust everybody. He said forgive everybody. Let me just keep on moving. Now we're going to come to the end of what Jesus said. He said this, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is a great way to start your day. Pray that you won't be led into temptation. Honestly, every young person, every younger leader, pray daily that you will not be led into temptation. Pray daily as you approach iPhones and iPads and your Android devices, pray that you won't be led into temptation throughout 2019. Keep your focus and your mind clean and clear. If there are things you need to repent of, repent from them and then replace them. So don't be led into compromising situations. Don't let your feet lead you to a place where you're considering sinning. Don't do it. You know, like Jesus just said, there's an evil one. And the evil one is hell-bent to destroy your life. And he is called the devil. He's the manifestation of evil. And he will cause you to be tempted. He will cause you to consider your options and that you will think about sinning. But the great thing is this. If you think about sinning, it's not sinning. Sinning is only when you actually follow through. So if you think about it and you deal with it and you ask Jesus to forgive you when that thought first comes into your mind and you're doing that in prayer, you are forgiven and clear. You're a son, you're a daughter of the living God, and you can move forward to enjoy your relationship with Jesus, totally forgiven and totally in peace. And that's why Ephesians 6:12 says that our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's not against the rulers and the powers of the dark world. No, the great thing is this, church, we're on the winning side. We're on the winning side. We're not praying. Some of us are going to be fasting over these 21 days and experiencing. We're not praying and fasting because we want to win. No, we have already won. The victory is already ours. So it's important we understand this. And that's why some Bible versions at the end of Matthew chapter 6 say this. They say, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Everything we're going through, everything I've talked about, everything we're about to experience is because we want all the glory to go to our God and our Savior. It's not for our sake, but for His sake. We want the glory to go to God. That is a way to pray. Now let me just put all this together, recap it, and say it like this. And if you know this, you can say it with me. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts even as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory